and a fool, and so have I. But come and be my wife, and let us try before we die to make some sense of life.
This Fichandler stage, this is the house that Zelda built that made the garden of American theater grow. Executive Director Edgar, Dobie, and I would like to thank all of the artists who came in to sing for us today on their day off. Thank you, artists. And to welcome Zelda's family, sons Hal and Mark Fichandler, and their families, her sister Joyce and her family, and all of our friends, colleagues, fans, and admirers who are with us today. What a distinct pleasure to have all of you gathered in this space. named after Zelda and Tom, to celebrate the spirit of this pioneering, determined, and luminous leader. As Zelda said, just think of it. Nobody was looking for us, peering through the window, watching for us to come to relieve the boredom and unawareness of their lives. It was we who had to teach and persuade them to want what we wanted to give them. And we had to insist on it for their own good, but really for our own, if we were honest enough to admit that. Sometimes it still feels like we're selling them a bill of goods to an overscheduled public, texting and emailing away. But mostly we've been successful. Nobody called us, but we came. This is from the Stage Directors and Choreographers Society presentation of the Zelda Fichandler Award, October 24th, 2011. How lucky are we to have lived during the time of Zelda? Zelda's the mother of us all in the American theater. It was her thinking as a seminal artist that imagined creating brilliant theater in our own communities outside of Broadway, along with Margot Jones and Nina Vance in Texas. As one of the major architects of the not-for-profit resident theater movement, she lives on in every single theater in America, now over 1,500 strong. And she wrote it all down. So many speeches coming out of her head, almost like Zeus. Her thinking and writing forged the creation and the very nature of our movement. Her legacy stretches from coast to coast. Arthur Miller wrote in the preface to Arena's 40th anniversary keepsake book, and we're now 67 years old, that Arena had the makings of a national theater for the U.S. Without Zelda, Margot Jones, and Nina Vance, there would not be this robust American theater landscape. So it was Zelda's vision that enabled a time when our vision at Arena for American work can thrive. She had a remarkable openness to new ideas, and most of all, to always, always support the artist. She remains with us, speaking fiercely from her speeches about the roadmap for our ongoing revolution for the theater, always questioning like a scholar, always pushing us to get to the heart of the matter. I have a small white ship riding outside my window in my office here, and I put it there to remind me of Zelda as a mothership. So I see her every day outside my window. When I was a young artistic director in training almost 40 years ago, I came to ArenaStage on a mini subscription. Now, Zelda was also a wonderful director. I was fortunate to see her absolutely brilliant Death of a Salesman with Bob Prosky and Inherit the Wind, one of the productions that went to Russia, the first theater to travel behind the Iron Curtain. While I was at ArenaStage as artistic director, Zelda returned to direct a breathtaking production of Awaken Sing. Her ideas in her speeches fueled me and encouraged my passions to aspire higher when I founded my own theater in Alaska, Perseverance Theater. She did this for so many of us, marching around the country like young Johnny Appleseeds, believing in this dream to create brilliant theater in our own communities outside of New York. She talked to us about boards and audiences and the art form itself and companies and the unique repertoire of every theater. We were thirsty, and she gave us water to drink. We were hungry to be inspired, and she asked the right big questions, and sometimes she told us the answers too. Today, many of the speakers will read a quote from Zelda. We were all deeply influenced by her. She will continue to be a major inspiration for our entire field. I'm lucky. I walk in her footprints every day. I'm reminded of the revolution she fought and won for artists and audiences alike. Her partner in this endeavor was her husband, Tom, as executive director. Their relationship forged a template for us to follow. She was absolutely unique, and we carry a bit of her star in each of our theaters. As she said in a speech titled Roles and Relationships, given at the TCG Symposium, Theater Communications Group Symposium, in June 1983, we exist for our audience. They are the terminus of our work. Otherwise, we wouldn't turn on the lights every night and could save some money. But in order to serve them, we have to have something to say. and show that is astonishing to them and that speaks to what they can't articulate without us. We have to address the subconscious or the preconscious of our audiences. We have to be of them, but in the perception of the world around us and the world that is inside of them, we have to be ahead of them. They can't do our field work for us. I don't hold much by questionnaires about what audiences want to see. How do they know until they see it? Zelda's a great friend to every artistic director in this country. How lucky are we to have lived during the time of this remarkable woman. Thank you, Zelda, for making all of our gardens grow.
I remember once having the opportunity to give a talk about Zelda. She warned me, you know, you'll have to say nice things about you. I said, Zelda, I welcome the opportunity to say nice things about you as long as I do not speak after you. I first met Zelda personally when I scared her. It wasn't Halloween, and I did not mean to frighten her. To be honest, she frightened me also. We met backstage at the bend of the steps going down to the Krieger dressing rooms. After we turned the corner and we met one another, she asked me, may I help you? I answered, hi, I'm Alan Hughes, and I work here. And I've been here for about a year. She may not have known who I was, but I certainly knew who she was. She was a co-founder and the strict but benevolent producing artistic director of ArenaStage, a job she would end up holding 40 years, from 1950 to 1990. Since that day, my life and Zelda's have been intertwined. Zelda and I have collaborated on a number of rewarding and successful projects. Her production of Arthur Miller's The Crucible took Washington, D.C. and Israel by storm. doing the Wake and Sing, I remember how Martha Knight, the stage manager, returned a cell phone message as she ate dinner in the theater. Martha was eating dinner. She told her friend how all of us, quote, youngsters, were trying to keep up with Zelda's seemingly endless energy. Most of you know that ArenaStage was born in 1950, when the National Theater, then the only equity theater in Washington, was shut down because blacks were not allowed in. So from the very beginning, Zelda had a special concern about racial fairness. Throughout Arena's history, this concern was evidenced by, among other things, experimentation with an integrated company, production of the controversial but highly successful production of The Great White Hope, and supporting artists like Sam R. Williams, Lorraine Hansberry, Raul Julia, Ruby Dee, R.C. Davis, Avery Brooks, Morgan Freeman, Tazewell Thompson, Paul Tazewell, and others. The quote I gave comes from a Zelda philosophy that I think is admirable. And I quote it again from an American theater article, The Lion Game, subtitled, "So You Want to Be an Actor. The First Step is Figuring Out Why in the World You Would Do Such a Thing." She states in the article, "In thinking about my own life, I've decided my greatest talent has been receiving criticism, incorporating it into my attend-to list, and moving on. I learned somehow that criticism is a gift, or at least a commodity, that can be very useful, and after all, comes free." I saw Zelda put that principle into practice. Zelda and another artistic director received criticism at a TCG conference about the lack of diversity at the theaters. Zelda incorporated the criticism into her to-do list. She went out, raised money to change the acting company, diversify the audience, and to begin the Fellows Program, which she kindly named after me. Amazing woman, and we are fortunate to have known her. I still hear her calm, sweet voice in my head. From the Valentine tea at the National Theater, February 14, 1990, she started the talk with, "Of course, my dear friends, I will be your Valentine. All you had to do was ask." She went on to answer Sigmund Freud's question, "What does woman want?" She ended with the words that I think she might repeat today. "I thank you, members of my human community, for the opportunity to have learned something of myself, to have had a role in making something of value, to have opened the way for some of you, for the opportunity to have gathered in your affection and respect. A richer Valentine's Day I've never had." Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Guy Berquist.
Having spent so many memorable, wonderful years working with some of you, and hoping the rest of you would buy tickets each year. In 1986, we were facing about middle of the season, we were facing about $100,000 deficit. Zelda was asked to address the Board of Trustees on the topic, artistic risk and money. The time when the artistic director is asked to talk about artistic risk is the time when there is a deficit on the books. Interest about artistic risk tends to be faint until aroused by a deficit. So the implicit request is to explain, defend, investigate, reassure, explicate, whatever, where the deficit is coming from. Artistic risk comes into the light when the financial picture clouds up. The first law of the theater is success. The theater has to meet its audience. It's a public art. 800 seats have to meet 800 faces and 800 bottoms to go in the seats. There's a joke you know about. A producer asked his partner, what should we cover the seats with? Should we cover them with plush or with tough nylon like they use on airplanes? The partner says, what difference does it make? Let's cover them with bottoms. The partner was right. And by the way, we did finish that year in the black. Yeah, why not? I feel privileged to have made a life-changing journey with Zell, from job applicant to employee to colleague to friend. And I'm probably as nervous right now as I was at that first interview. Preparing for one of my early meetings with Zell, I asked my predecessor, Nancy Quinn, what she and Zell talked about other than work. I wish I could do the accent. Nancy said, well, we usually talk about shoes and shopping. Zell would sometimes come into the production office, no real purpose, just hanging out. Carl Mueller, our first company manager in the early 80s, remembers the time she beat us all to a ringing telephone answering, Joe's Pizza. We were doing a Shaw, Man and Superman, directed by Doug Wager. Zell always watched previews from Box K right up there. The show was long, very long, especially long on first preview. It was 11:30, maybe a little later. We still had a few scenes to go. And there was a parade going past Box K. And Zell would lean over, smile, and wave goodnight to him. I remember one man saying in a full voice, you cut Shakespeare, why not Shaw? And she smiled and said, I think the series of events that sealed our bond came in the late 90s. Arena was contemplating construction, expansion, and possibly a move away from this 6th and Main site, abandoning the Arena and Krieger theaters after so many historic performances. Zelda strongly opposed the move, as did I, and I remember Joanne Overholt and I spent New Year's Eve and day 1999 helping Zell write, copy, and post letters to board members, urging them to reach the decision that kept us here. We probably shouldn't have used the postage meter, but we did. Eight years ago, Zelda retired from NYU and moved back to DC, where she found herself without institutional support, without an assistant for the first time in decades. A couple of former fellows tried to help, but as anyone who's ever worked for Zell knows, when she says part-time, she means 24/7 availability. Enter Angie Morris. Working for me on the construction project. I asked if she had a little time to ask to help Zelda, who was starting to organize her papers in preparation for the book. Doing a few little things led to an ongoing friendship, an extraordinary working relationship, and at times, it was hard to know who was really working for whom. One of the last times I spoke with Zell, I was telling her about a mentorship award I received. And it's all your fault, I said. And she says, no, 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 you earned it. And then she paused and corrected herself and said, well, maybe half of it is my doing. As construction on this facility reached finishing stages, Zell was ready to take a look. We toured the entire complex. Finally, I opened the doors to the Fichandler stage. Zell stepped in, looked around, deadly silence. Finally, she said, it's better than the original. Thank you, Zell, for making us all better.
The arena to the Krieger to the old vat and back again, hoping to catch her eye while praying she wouldn't notice me and all my awkwardness. I was in awe of her intellect, reading and rereading her words, desperately trying to keep up in staff meetings, retreats, first rehearsals, not wanting to miss a word of the next phrase that would be the one that would unlock a whole world. I was graced by her friendship, particularly in this past decade. When we weren't sharing stories of children and grandchildren, or talking politics, history, world events, she was inspiring me, compelling me, I guess demanding, that I not waste a moment of my time. I must harness and direct my ambition in the service of the soul of the theater. I must be tough in the service of something that is tender. In 2008, I arrived at the Stage Directors and Choreographers Society on the eve of the 50th anniversary. Founded by a tight group of Broadway stars, SDC had grown to become a national force in support of directors working across the country. We challenged ourselves to find a way to mark the moment. It was decided that the SDC Foundation, the not-for-profit foundation of SDC, would establish an award to recognize an outstanding director or choreographer who is making a unique and exceptional contribution to the theater in their work regionally. And it would be named for Zelda. Zelda was a leader among leaders, and she loved directors, directors with expansive vision, with unrelenting passion, who pursued their craft with tenacity, always setting the bar higher and higher. Directors with drive and determination to bring something into being. Zelda was deeply committed to inspiring those who followed in the footsteps of the founders. And with all her heart, she wanted to shore them up as they faced the daily challenges of their chosen ministry, requiring that they, as she and her peers had, demand the best of themselves and those around them. Over many months, working closely with Zelda, we developed the criteria. The award would not be for lifetime achievement. It would be to honor an artist for both accomplishment to date and promise for the future. We would witness an artist in the center of their artistic life, working with the same passion and dedication as the founders of the regional theater movement. Founders such as Margot Jones, Bill Ball, Tyrone Guthrie, Gordon Davidson. The award would recognize remarkable artists dedicating themselves to a community. The award would be for work that is hard, for work that is necessary, and it would encourage these artists to carry on to ensure that dynamic, extraordinary directors can thrive and create great work all across the country. And in honor of Zelda, it would be for courage and bravery. And her word, not mine, it would not be for sissies. Since its inception in 2009, there have been 8 winners, 21 finalists, out of hundreds of nominations. Some knew her well and are with us today. Others are artists that may not have had the opportunity to sit with her, to speak with her. And in the years ahead, there will be many more who, through this award, will take with them a bit of her spirit and the responsibility to carry on. I think it brought her great joy to know these artists, and that she would appreciate knowing that SDC would join with many in this room to carefully steward her legacy. She changed our hearts and minds and the world. She altered our DNA. To meet her was a visceral experience. She was a force. You were changed. I know she's here in ourselves, in the walls. In 2009, Zelda wrote a speech that was to be delivered by Jane Alexander at our gala announcing the award. The speech was way too long. way too long. And it arrived at the 11th hour. I know that's shocking. I was struggling to get into my gown. Tom Moore, an SDC executive board member and the champion of the award, was on one side with a red pen. On the other was Jane Alexander and Ed Sheeran, and Zelda was on speed dial. When I looked back a few weeks ago through my Zelda files to try to prepare for this moment, I found a fax with a few suggested cuts, only if we had to, but we had to. In these nuggets of pure gold, one paragraph stood out. It felt like she left it there for me to find, to share with you today. We are originals. We come into this world at the cost of alternate ovulations, alternate lives, really. The chance of our being our parent's son or daughter is in the vicinity of 1 in 10 million. The fundamental identity that we are born with may or may not at all suit the identities of our mother or father. We may even be born in the wrong house or even into the wrong destiny. But if we have the talent to create a beautiful thing that wouldn't be there but for us, we are blessed. And in addition to repairing the world, we have the opportunity to repair ourselves, make ourselves whole, a project that can engage us for a lifetime, and for which I believe we have landed on the earth. Thank you.
Executive Director of TCG. She would reminisce about TCG's founding in 1961, how she was one of a few folks who were invited to the Ford Foundation to discuss the idea of starting this association of theaters that would exist nationally, and what a big deal it was. She also reminisced about the red dress she wore to mark the occasion. I got my start here in Washington, D.C. in the early 1980s at the Woolly Mammoth Theater Company, which was recently formed as a new kind of theater that would shake up the nation. Perhaps the very fact that there was a perceived need for such a shaking up meant that the resident theater movement had done its job. It had arrived and established itself enough over 3 decades to inspire a next generation of theater makers who would set out to challenge it, to try something new, to start another revolution, just as Zelda and her colleagues had done when they founded ArenaStage and fueled a resident theater movement. What Zelda set in motion was not a static gift for the benefit of a single community or era. She carved out a model that others of her own and future generations could replicate or at least approximate, and a generous ecosystem that others could participate in and draw strength from. Through her constant assessment, critique, and unending passion for the work, she gave everyone in this field an artistic and intellectual compass that reminded us why our theaters exist, along with a reality check that there may never be a time when the challenges endemic to this work will finally be overcome. In The Long Revolution, Zelda said, quote, "We wanted to create a form for theater that would enable us to insert meaning and beauty into our culture so that people could reach out and touch it, simply and directly. Despite hazards and harassments, we have in our various ways done just that. It was a miracle of sorts, for not only did we have to construct the methods to carry out our idea, but we had to train an audience to know that they wanted to have what we wanted to give them, and that was not an easy struggle. And of course, it still goes on," unquote. Zelda wasn't kidding about the miracle of the movement. She often paraphrased a quote from her hero and movement co-founder you've been hearing about, Margot Jones, who said in the 1940s, "Imagine if there were 40 theaters across the country. What a rich land we would be. How the experience of life that all those theaters could afford would enrich the lives of its citizens." Zelda, along with Margot and Nina Vance at the Alley Theater, are our founding mothers, all starting theaters within a few years of each other. Now, in 2016, we stand in a national theatrical landscape that includes not just 40, but thousands of nonprofit resident theaters, hundreds of thousands of theater makers, millions of audience members, and billions of dollars of economic impact. By the way, I don't think economic impact was one of the driving forces in Zelda's mind when she envisioned the founding of theaters outside New York. But I thought it was worth noting, because we live in a world where the contributions of our theaters and artists are vast, and the challenges of staying afloat are sometimes vaster. And if there is any unfinished business, one of the pieces is how to accomplish greater economic resources for our field combined with greater equity within the field. And I am proud that we are working on that together and indeed following Zelda's lead as she believed in this. Among the hazards in the early days was getting audiences to care about both classics and new work, creating a whole new funding model, including making 501c3 status available to theater. Eventually, it was dealing with the culture wars alongside the challenges of increasing competition from technology and new media. All of these making it more difficult to generate and maintain that simplicity that Zelda talked about, the moments when artist and audience come together in real time and space for the experience of something beautiful on stage. And yet, none of it stopped her. Those of us who were part of the national theater community and audience today are the beneficiaries of what Zelda created. From the very first minute, she had the notion that it was important to create a form for theater that would enable us to insert meaning and beauty into our culture, to her resilience and ability to question assumptions, articulate purpose, restructure broken systems, and reinvent. Her vision brought about the widespread employment of theater artists nationwide, a wider platform for new work, a bridge between the commercial and nonprofit worlds, support for a diverse pool of artists, designers, and technicians, and especially she brought something of beauty to the community, whether or not that community knew they wanted it. While we stand now on the shoulders of a giant and reap the benefits of her creation, we are in no position to rest on those laurels or coast on the successes. Rather, in Zelda's honor, we and future generations must look at what the world is asking of theater makers today. We must build on what exists while carving out new theatrical life that responds to the artistic, economic, and political present we inhabit, and recognize that our journey is about making the world better, not just for us, but because of us. In so doing, we may have to construct new methods and train new audiences and communities to want what we have to give. Along the way, we may navigate new hazards and harassments, but taking constant inspiration from Zelda's memory, from what she accomplished and what she gave us, we will go on, and we will make her spirit proud. Thank you.
Stephen Wade.
A few days after Zelda died, her sons Mark and Hal hosted an open house at her apartment in Northwest DC. Her presence, still luminous, warmed the afternoon gathering of colleagues, family, and neighbors. As we left, Mark invited departing visitors to take home a book or two from Zelda's shelves. My eyes fell upon this much-paged tome, The Complete Works of Shakespeare. Zelda used this volume during her graduate years at George Washington University. Its pages marked with margin notes and underlining, she penned her name and address inside the front cover. But it wasn't until that evening that I realized something else about it, something I found a bit startling and certainly gratifying, a name written on its spine. Harvard's legendary professor, George Lyman Kittredge, had edited the collection. Born in 1860, this tall, white-bearded scholar who died in 1941 had become during his lifetime a dominant figure in the humanities, leaving behind a bibliography of 383 writings, a body of work spanning Shakespeare to Chaucer to Mallory. Teacher to both Franklin Roosevelt and William S. Burroughs, he was also the most influential American folklorist of his time. Kittredge not only completed the last of his mentor's work, the final volume of Francis James Child's canonical, The English and Scottish Popular Ballads, but he also pivotally encouraged and instructed collectors who fanned out across the country to document its informal traditions. Without these individuals and their efforts, I'd surely not have had the contents for my banjo dancing show. Kittredge encouraged his acolytes to pursue what he termed, quote, the many phases of our strangely multifarious life and manners. In Zelda's apparently infinite capacity to variously describe the actor's ability to represent the human condition, she too embraced many phases of our strangely multifarious life and manners. Quote, the warm curve of faces, answering flicker of eyes, the set of a head, the lift of a shoulder, the way hands spread and clench, unquote. From the street scene prologue to the USA trilogy, these gestures speak as much to theater as they do to custom. Both Zelda and Kittredge reckoned with behaviors that touch the immediate and the enduring. One need only look at Zelda's notes penciled throughout this book. Zelda engages line by line with the plays and their intent. She even writes glosses on Kittredge's headnotes, responding with questions as well as comments. Kittredge, fluent in Latin, Greek, Old Norse, Middle English, and Icelandic, and who graduated with highest honors from Harvard, never pursued a doctorate. A story, admittedly apocryphal, recalls when he was asked why not, he replied, "But who would examine me?" Likewise, Zelda, a figure no less redoubtable, asserted that art is not a democracy. Surely circumstances required nothing less of her, yet she unswervingly cleaved to an inclusive social vision. She described this very room as the most democratic of spaces. One that allowed the audience to see itself through the screen of the actors, their words and gestures reinforcing the democratic humanity of shared experience. Back in 1997, when Tom Fichandler died, Zelda asked me to play at his service, held also in this theater. I reprise that tune now, but add one more for her, a piece historically and musically related to the first. Two tunes, different but entwined, like Tom and Zelda, or like this venerable opus. In its compass, Zelda Diamond Fitchandler and George Lyman Kittredge become companions immemorial. I stand indebted to them and their large souls.
dread this opportunity today. This is a deeply personal, almost surreal moment for me, standing before you over 40 years since the day I first stood here as a wide-eyed 25-year-old intern from Boston University. Zelda's passing has been something of an epiphany for me, as I imagine it may have been for many of you here. I was asked if I could perhaps share with you one of my favorite Zelda stories, so here we go. Zelda and I began working closely together not long after my arrival at Arena, beginning with my stage managing for her, moving on to serving as Arena's first literary manager, and eventually as associate director. However, my relationship with Zelda extended well beyond the boundaries of my professional life, and as anyone who worked directly with her can attest to, there was an unspoken 24/7 devoted expectation to be of service when called upon. Zelda called one day to ask me if I would mind accompanying her, as she had been invited by her sister Joyce to go sailing, and she didn't want to go alone. As I remember, Joyce was then dating a gentleman, a self-confessed neophyte sailing enthusiast, who had recently purchased a 30-foot sailboat aboard in Annapolis. While we boarded the boat, Zelda, fashionably attired in a one-piece bathing suit and beach jacket ensemble, replete with sunglasses and a large, full-brimmed straw Santa hat. I was drafted by our captain as first mate, though I, at the time, had zero sailing skills. I helped us direct it. We motored into Chesapeake Bay as there was little breeze and raised sail once we were in open water. We were drifting along when suddenly the wind picked up, filled the sails, and we were off. And just as suddenly, we stopped, abruptly, as the boat's keel had apparently hit a shallow submerged sandbar. No one on the boat knew quite what to do, except to hope that the tide would eventually rise to set us free, when the wind caught Zelda's straw sun hat and blew it into the bay. I looked at her, she looked at the hat, and back to me, her hair flying in the breeze, and I said, "I'll get it." And I dove overboard, swimming to retrieve her hat. When I finally reached it, I put it on my head, I turned to swim back and saw Zelda and the boat briskly sailing away. Unfortunately, my exit from the boat had been enough to lighten the load and free the keel. Eventually had the presence of mind to lower the sails and motor back to me. However, he had not yet acquired a ship's ladder to hang over the side to assist in my retrieval. So he, Joyce, and Zelda all pitched in to unceremoniously haul me back on board, and gratefully, the rest of the day was a pleasure. Today, much of the time since her passing feels to me a little bit like that, treading water, shaded from the sun by her big hat, and watching her sail inevitably away. My relationship with Zelda changed my life forever. Stop for a moment, close your eyes, and take a second to try and recall the incident in your life, your career, the moment when the dream came true for you. I came here to do a 10-week internship. Stayed 25 years, and in the most profound sense, never left. Or rather, Arena has never left me. When I arrived here, the company had just returned from a triumphant tour of the Soviet Union with Zelda's production of Inherit the Wind and Alex Schneider's Our Town. I started as a production assistant on Livy Chule's American debut production of Buchner's Leontes and Lena, and assisted Alan on the world premiere of Elie Wiesel's The Madness of God, all in the space of my first 10 weeks. Little did I know at the time that I would have the miraculous privilege of working and collaborating together daily, show after show, year after year, with so many extraordinary gifted actors, craftspeople, technicians, and administrative staff, some literally for decades. You only have to multiply my story 100,000 times to even begin to fathom the impact Zelda's visionary work has had on the lives and careers of countless theater artists and practitioners, young, old, and those yet to be conceived, all across this country. It is crazy. From the sheer volume of creative potential she unleashed, a virtual tsunami of creativity born from one simple idea, the desire to create a space where both artists and audiences could continuously and regularly share the intimate and active imaginative exchange of live storytelling. Zelda had no notion at the time that she was founding a movement, that she was creating what would become known as the artistic home. In 2012, HowlRound interview series entitled In Search of the Artistic Home, Todd London postulated a menu of essential elements, criteria for building the ideal artistic home for others. And he concluded with this following statement. To make an artistic home for others, you have to make a place of love for the art in others. That's it. You have to love the art in others more than you love yourself in the art, to twist Stanislavski. And you have to remind yourself day after day that the reason you're doing this is because you want to live in that love. You want to live in the feeling of the world becoming art and art speaking back to the world. For me and for all of us who had the privilege of being an ongoing part of the Arena community, that love was real. A priceless, unprecedented growth opportunity to make work together as a company on a daily basis, to stretch and test our wings, collaborate with world-class artists, ever striving to work at the height of our collective creative potential. When Zelda approached me in 1980 about taking on the position of associate director, she prefaced it by asking me if I wanted to learn how to become an artistic director, advising me that I would likely have to curtail my career as a director to invest in the process of learning how to best guide and nurture the work of others, and embrace the challenge of mastering the fine art of institutional leadership. In her own words, Zelda said, referring to the 1959 reformation of Arena as a not-for-profit entity, that thing acquired a name, a rather awkward name, I must say, the not-for-profit regional theater. The Ford Foundation had first suggested residential theater, but we protested. It sounded like a home for young girls. Whatever the name, we loved it because it was where we have found an opportunity to work, to grow, to experience the deep pleasure of making a contribution through the art form we're committed to, and to avoid spending our brief candle searching for a place where we could be of use, the deepest need of every human being. Zelda relished nurturing the artist-audience relationship, treated it as a provocative, ongoing conversation about the confounding and often contradictory mysteries of existence in the human condition. At the October 1960 groundbreaking ceremony for this building, Zelda said, "Our aim is no less than this, to bring life to life. And by this aim, we are urgently and indissolubly connected to the world we live in and to the people we live for. We are a theater of audiences. We are not an idle or esoteric experiment. We live to illuminate life and make it more meaningful and joyful." Zelda was my stage mom. She was my mentor, a dearly cherished colleague whom I both respected and loved. She was also a loving personal friend. Last night, because my wife was unable to come today due to some personal circumstances and work, she queued up a home video clip of Zelda sitting on our patio 17 years ago, playing "This Little Piggy Went to Market," gleefully tweaking the toes of my then six-month-old daughter, Miranda. And that was her to me. I last saw Zelda several weeks before she passed and spent the better part of an afternoon with her along with her son, Mark. I hadn't seen her in over a year. By then she was quite frail and fading, periodically drifting in and out of lucidity, but we were able to communicate. And as I was preparing to leave, I knew it would be the last time I would see her. I didn't know quite what to do, so I impulsively grabbed her hand and told her I loved her. Her eyes suddenly lit up, and she smiled, gripping my hand with unexpected strength, and said, "I love you too." And then a few seconds later, we made a lot of people love us, didn't we? I said yes. Thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions. She smiled and said, without missing a beat, "You mean more than 12? Not getting it, I leaned in and I kissed her forehead and said goodbye. Puzzling over her final comment on the drive back to Philadelphia, it suddenly struck me she must have heard my millions as minions. Perhaps a final ephemeral wink of levity and light. So here I stand, metaphorically treading water, still shaded from the sun by her big straw hat, watching her sail haplessly away, an apt metaphor perhaps for my grief, my love for her, and for the seminal influence she had on my life. Right now, standing here with you, I feel, however fleetingly, in this moment, home once again. So, dear Zelda, one last goodbye, and thank you for teaching me the simple truth that you can come home again, that wherever life leads me, home will always be where the art is.
Tickets to see the 1940s radio hour in the Krieger Theater. And my father spent a good deal of his life in radio. He was an entertainer. He and his partner, Maxie Zides, a nice Jewish boy from Brookline, a nice Irish boy from South Boston, formed a singing duo. And they were very, very popular in vaudeville and on the stage in the 30s, the 20s and 30s. And so it was personal for him. He came out, and I met them in the parking lot afterwards, the Men Don't Cry guy. And I said, "Well, how did you enjoy it?" And he had his head sideways, kind of looking down. My mother said, "Oh, he cried through the whole thing." I came down here, strangely enough, when I read on the little thing, they said that would be preferred to have 5 minutes. Crap, 5 minutes? I can't even say good morning in 5 minutes. So I'll take whatever time I need. When I came down here in 1972, it was after a rather traumatic period in my life. I had been very successful as a young actor. I was then making a lot of money doing a nationally syndicated children's show called Earthland, and doing Jacques Brel for 2 years, the musical Jacques Brel, the production in Boston, and also doing a lot of voiceover work and making a lot of money and having a fine time. I bought myself a little airplane, a partnership on an airplane, which I managed to, sort of as a punctuation mark on that period of my life, crashed. And I was in the hospital for quite a while. The play ended, the umbrella ended, the television show was canceled, and I found out how fast the money you save can go when there's none coming in. So I decided, with my degree from Harvard in English and literature, to go back into what I originally wanted to do was to be a journalist. So I decided to try my hand at freelance journalism. I was married with four children, and I needed income coming in. So this is how blind chance plays a role in our lives. I came down here to cover a story on children's television for the FCC. A Boston newspaper hired me to do an article for them on the FCC hearing on children's television. And during the boring hearings, during the lunch break, I decided to come over here to ArenaStage to see an old friend of mine who was Zelda's assistant at that time, and see if he was here and chat with him. And I did. I came over. He was here. He said, "Hey, come on in. How are you, Tony?" And great. So we got to chatting. Told him I was through with the theater. I was going back into journalism. That was what I wanted to do. Theater, I just had to have steady work. I couldn't do theater anymore. So he said, "Shucks, that's too bad." I said, "Why is it too bad?" He said, "Well, Zelda's just down the way. We were just talking. We're having a hard time finding someone to play Editor Webb in our town. But if you're not interested," I said, well, he said, "Well, listen, I have the script here, and here's one of the speeches. Zelda's just down the hall. Just take a look at it, and I'll send you down there." So I did. I went in to see Zelda. She listened and said, "You know, the problem is the audition, tomorrow's the last day of auditions. Alan Schneider's directing. He's in New York. Can you be in New York tomorrow morning before noon?" I said, "Yes." So I dropped the news story. Went into New York, auditioned for Alan Schneider, and at the end of the audition, Alan said, "Great, can you begin in October?" I said, "Yeah, sure." Yeah. So I had a job at ArenaStage. Little did I know that it was going to be 25 years. I hadn't planned to tell this story at all. It just happened. The wonderful thing that my daughter, I gotta tell you this. When I called my daughter worked in the box office here. One of my daughters worked in the box office here. And I called her up and was chatting with her. I said, "Oh, by the way, I've been asked to speak at Zelda's memorial service. Isn't that nice?" And she said, "Yes, yeah, that's nice, Dad. But just remember, it's about Zelda now." I learned in the course of my years here with Zelda that she was not good at small talk. Always uncomfortable in unstructured social situations. She was just not good at just hanging out and talking. But you put her in the director's chair or on a podium, she was eloquent and brilliant and inspired. She confessed to me that when she was a young girl, more than anything else, she secretly wanted to be a chorus girl. Well, I smiled politely. Sure. And so one evening, she asked me that if I would entertain at a gathering of the angels. So they still have angels here, people who volunteer for the theater. So she wanted to give them an evening's entertainment. And she knew I played guitar and sang. I said, "Sure, I'd love to do it." So I did. I brought my guitar along. And I said, "Oh, by the way, would you mind if I invited my father? He's in a retirement home out in Reston. He's an old performer. I have him sing a couple of songs." I said, "Oh, no, that would be great." So I did. I called my dad and said, "Oh, yeah, I'd love to." So we came. There were, you know, quite a large, it was down in the old vat room. And quite a large number of people, quite a crowd. I was very pleased with that. So I got up, Zelda introduced me, I got up and sang two or three songs, and then I introduced my father and told him about his vaudeville career, what an entertainer he was. And he got on stage, and I went and sat in the front row while he entertained them for 40 minutes. I got back up on the stage 40 minutes later to do the finale number with my father, which we had always done at when we were asked to sing together. We did Alexander's Ragtime Band. And he played piano, he was quite a good piano player. And I got up there next to him on the stage, and we started going into it. Come on, come on, and let me take you by the hand. Dun, dun. You know the song. But about midway through the song, and the light's like this blinding, you can't really see anything. Midway through the song, I noticed someone in the aisle dancing. Doing this. It was Zelda. And she was being the Zelda that we didn't know. The Zelda who was not spoken of so in such eloquent terms. The mother, the sister, the aunt, the grandmother, you know, the human side of Zelda really came out with it. And I knew that there was somebody under there who was not exactly like the Zelda that's sat in the office upstairs. And she once said that, she once told me in privacy that the driving force behind her ambition was to win her father's love. You know, and I said, well, join the club. I guess the final message that I have is that Zelda was a lot more than we ever imagined. Thank you.
She was formidable to me before I even met her. Auditioning for the great Zelda Fichandler was the first of many crucial moments in my growth as an artist. It was one of those moments when it was affirmed to me that I was actually on the right track. She watched me perform in a hotel conference room in February in freezing cold Chicago and read my statement of purpose almost simultaneously. It was petrifying. I was sure I was toast. I decided to put it all out there in my statement of purpose and see who did. To state that I planned to tell African women stories, that I was a Zimbabwean as well as an American, and I felt a calling to give back to my homeland, to invest in the artistic life there, that it was an intricate part of my artistic integrity and identity. Watching her read it, I was sure I'd be a total turn-off. What do you do with a girl whose heart is on another continent? Who wants to tell African stories, for God's sake? I was certain she was about to kindly dismiss me. Instead, and to my great surprise, she was intrigued, asking why so much focus on Africa. When I shared my story, she told me she had a stone sculpture from my country, an unexpected point of interest, but I would take it. When I explained my need to contribute to African artists, a moment I was sure I was going to turn her off entirely, she nodded and looked me so deep in the eye, her perfectly coiffed hair framing her own intensely deep brown eyes, and she said something I'll never forget. Some of us must go forth and be pioneers. I nodded back, surprised. That affirmation led to 3 years of amazing training under her leadership at Tishgrad. When I had my first year breakdown, a rite of passage at any conservatory, she supported me and got me through it. When I created a piece for our annual free play, an amazing invention of Miss Fichandler, third-year artists to create their own pieces and perform them. She watched the very first public performance of what turned out to be my very first play in the continuum. First show. All I remember doing was pouring out my heart and praying the audience would get it. The story of this involving women realizing she's contracted HIV. Zelda certainly did get it. And afterwards, she walked up to me and told me she believed I had a tremendous gift to tell a story and said she could not imagine what I would do with it. Her brilliance as a leader, a pioneer, steering the ship since the 1950s in American repertory theater, crafting a phenomenal training program, one that encouraged you to create from a place of courage and conviction, but also face your demons and be ready to, as she always beautifully put it, be private in public. She created a repertory company out of every class and taught us what it meant to create art. It's about collaboration. It's about leaving your ego outside the door and relentlessly seeking truth. Watching her served for me as a blueprint of how crucial a role women play in positions of power and leadership. How very needed women leaders are. When I graduated, I went through the grueling agent audition process. I remember catching up with her on how it was going in the ladies' room, no less. She listened, and then gave me some of the soundest advice I've ever received. Just always have a place to go. Remember, you have the talent. They need you. They will be lucky to have you. So never stay too long. Always have another place to go. And be gracious, be present. She said, I designed this program so artists would never sit by the phone. You know what you can do. Nothing ever stops you from doing it. Those sound words resonate in the souls of all those she's touched over the several years she worked in this industry. They resonate into all the work I do, and the Zimbabwean artists I'm now able to support and guide in arts and arts education. It is her model that I hope to replicate when I do build home, a school back home. Why improve on what is ideal and what works? I am so sorry I did not get to see her before she passed, and how sorely she will be missed. But she lives on in me and in so many others. The chain effect of her amazing legacy will never be broken. She is and was a true American she.
Making me a student for life, internally conscious of of receiving and filtering good news and glad tidings. Birthed in double Gemini, with a new moon in Capricorn, this cosmic Milky Way formation would lead me on a life path journey that would connect me in the still formative period of my life to she who would shape mist into substance, Zelda Fichandler. Zelda was a dear friend, mentor, and because I lacked a mother in my life, I latched on to her, and she allowed that attachment. She brought me to ArenaStage in 1987. It changed my life. We wrote letters, cards, notes to each other, even though sometimes in the same building, on the same floor, for almost 30 years. We spoke by phone, endlessly or in short spurts, on a wild variety of topics, several times a month, and in the last years, 2 to 3 times a week. She provided me with a reading list of plays and authors that I must want to know. She entertained me with memorized lyrics of standards from the 1930s and 40s, and I return a lyric to you now, Zel. The way you haunt my dreams, the way you changed my life. No, 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 they can't take that away from me. She read drafts of my plays, giving me incisive, perceptive, and cogent notes. She dramaturged all my productions while here at ArenaStage, or at NYU, or the acting company, from as far as Cape Town and Tokyo, Berlin, Madrid, Vancouver. In spite, or despite, an horrific argument many years ago over my wanting to work independently elsewhere, and her insisting I stay within the company, I'll encapsulate that argument. She had been avoiding me for several weeks. I had wanted to sit down and talk with her about my next steps, leaving ArenaStage. She came up with many excuses. After making an appointment, I have to have my hair done. I need to meet with a board member. I have to go grocery shopping. Finally, I called her and she picked up the phone and we started to argue. And we really went at it. In the midst of it, she said, I won't be treated like four-letter expletive. And I replied, well, I won't be treated like four-letter expletive. And it went on, and it escalated. And then finally I said, and I can't believe I have the gall, the audacity to say it. Even now, I can't believe I said, Zell, I just want to be released. I want to be free from the ArenaStage plantation. Just been doing. You have been hurling expletives at the Chanel suit-wearing mafia queen of the regional theater movement, your life is over. She returned to the phone and she said, I had to put the phone down because someone entered the room. And I said, who? Alan Schneider. What do you mean? Alan and I fought just like this, and I haven't had a fight with anyone since Alan. We fought in the parking lot, we fought in the office, we fought over the phone, we fought over lunch, and Alan would always say it's not personal, and I would tell Alan, oh no, Alan, it's very personal. Putting together a production is very, very personal. Outside of my family is the most personal thing that I will ever do. And so we fought. Zelda wasn't ready to let go of that argument. She said to me, I'd like to help you leave ArenaStage. And perhaps after you visit the prop shop and they take off the chains and shackles. Startups. Right here in the district, and in Virginia, and in Maryland, in the suburbs, there's all these theaters popping up. Dinner theaters. I think they call them beef and boards. I'd like to write you a letter of recommendation. You can always do the good person of Szechuan while they're serving Szechuan steak. Or you could perhaps do dinner at 8, although their dinner starts at 5 and 6, so as not to interfere with coffee and dessert during the second act of Death of a Salesman. I'd love to write that letter for you. I've been told that I have a very good turn of phrase. And when I write a letter, it's not from head to hand automatic. I put everything I can into it. Because, Taz, you should have a career that you want and deserve. I stayed on, and I stayed on, and I stayed on. It was the best decision Zelda ever made. I was once working with a student designer at NYU, and the student designer, months ahead before the first rehearsal, she and I were not seeing eye to eye at all. I would bring in research, and she would bring in research that had nothing to do with my research or the homework that I had given her. It was not working. I went to Zelda, she sent me to the design department, and we talked and talked, and we tried to make it work with the design student, and it was just not going to work. I finally insisted, bringing Zelda and the design department together, that we all know this is not going to work and something must be done. The student was replaced. A week after that in rehearsals, I was feeling very guilty, and I visited Zelda's office, and I said, I feel terrible. A design student, a student, has been fired because of me. And she said, it happens to most of us. Somewhere in our lives, it happens to most of us. And I said, Zell, you've never been fired. And she said, Taz, I'm not most of us. Remarkable, renegade, witty, relentless, stylish, classy, resilient, empathetic, fallible, uncompromising, vulnerable, visionary, vain, genius, magician, phoenix, soulful, radiant, romantic, transcendent, splendid. And now the planets have clashed and the whole world has shifted. Out of a chaotic sky and the times teeming with lightning, leaning in sorrow in the saddened aftermath of your passing, artists are left dashed, shocked and shivering, fending for ourselves, reaching for the eternal dream and the transitory light you left us. How are we to catch our breath again? From Walt Whitman, we receive you and with free sense at last, and are insentient henceforward. Not you anymore shall be able to foil us or withhold yourself from us. We use you and we do not cast you aside. We plant you permanently within us. We fathom you not. We love you. There's perfection in you also. You furnish your parts towards eternity, great or small. You furnish your parts toward the soul. And finally, from Shakespeare, the soldier's pole has fallen. Young boys and girls are level now with men. The odds is gone. And there is nothing left remarkable beneath the visiting moon.
Celebrating a life. It's not about death. But Zelda spoke a great deal about death with me and probably with other people. Her plans for it, as if she could manage it. The way that she managed her career with steely control. She said to me often, "When I die, I do not want a big thing at ArenaStage." Which, of course, I took to mean, I do want. And how appropriate. This was her space. This was her living room. This was her synagogue. This was an extension of her mind. I always knew that this was where we would gather to remember her. And Molly, and Edgar, and Kadi, and everyone at Arena who helped put this on, thank you so much for making it happen. Because it's really the right thing. She used to have an office, as God knows, right up there behind what used to be Box K, where they were, you know, the boxes were removed. And at intermission, we would go up there and we'd hang out in her office and we'd drink Cokes, and there was a squat box on her desk, and they would say, 5 minutes, please, and we would sneak back out of the office and sit in her box. And when I first came here, when the theater had been reconfigured, and I thought, like I said, it's better. And I said to Mom sheepishly, it's better. She said, but they need the seats. How can they afford not to have the seats? And then she saw and she said, yeah, it's better. So yeah, it became more intimate and maybe even more a little like what she had envisioned. Zelda used to say, I want to live to see Hillary become president. And then she would say, I mean, who would want to be president, right? I would never want to be president. Which I sort of took to mean maybe she's considering being president. But she died just a few hours after Hillary was nominated. So I guess she really decided to let another woman take the job. She had accomplished enough. I want to recognize a few family members and some friends who are here. Peggy, I don't know where you're sitting. Peggy, while I was training on the Zelda's assistant. She was Zelda's assistant for decades, and Hal and I adored her. And I tortured her a bit when I used to be parked in front of her desk after school and no one knew what to do with me, and I would string all her paper clips together on the square desk. But she was very tolerant. Jan Whitehead, Mom's dearest friend, is here, and I'm really delighted to see her as well. As well. And then in terms of family, our one and only cousin, we have a very small family, Robert Goldstein is here, who's been really a great help throughout this whole time. His wonderful, gorgeous wife, Maura, who always felt so welcomed into the family by Zelda when she became part of our little tribe. And their charming and very smart son, Adam Harry. Thank you for coming. Our Uncle Bill, who Zelda really adored, she loved his knowledge of politics and history, and they had long, complex conversations on the state of the country. My partner of 32 years, Paul Travis, who Zelda also had great admiration and fondness for. We've been through the loss of parents together, and he is and will always be my love and support. And finally, Zelda's sister, Bill's wife, Rob's mother, Maura's mother-in-law, Adam's grandmother, our aunt, Joyce Diamond Simons. When I was a little bit in love with Joyce, and I asked her to stop getting older so I could catch up and marry her. That didn't quite work out for a number of reasons. But Joyce and Zelda were very close. They spoke daily, sometimes many times a day. Joyce held Mom's hand through rough times, physical and emotional, and she would go up to see her in New York. Sometimes I didn't even know this, just to give her an embrace and take care of her when she needed a little support. In some ways, Joyce, I think this has been hardest on you, and how I just want to acknowledge all the support and sisterly love that you've shared over these many years.
Ladies and gentlemen, Matthew Fichandler.
So, my grandmother sent me a lot of letters. Didn't have to be a birthday or a holiday or a special occasion, just if she had something to say. So, about 3 times a day. when I was younger, my dad would read these letters to me out loud because I couldn't read cursive yet. And then I got older and I learned cursive, and I learned that her letters were not in cursive, she just had really wacky handwriting. And at first, I responded to all of her letters in full. I respond to all her questions, ask her some questions, and I tell her how excited I was to come visit her so we could make freshly squeezed orange juice in the morning. And then as time went on, I got busier, responses got shorter and a little less personal, but instead I started to send her my writing, my scripts, my essays, my stories. She wanted to read everything. So she would send responses to these writings. And I could tell by the fact that her responses were longer than my stories that she learned more about me through my writings than she ever could through a direct letter, because she thought I was being more honest with what I was putting on the page. So I thought it'd be appropriate to not share a story, but share one more letter that I would write to her and read to her if she was here. So here it is. Dear Grammy, thank you for the letter. Thank you for the newspaper clippings, the trinkets, and the gifts. Thank you for noticing when I got a haircut, new glasses, or grew an inch. Thank you for sitting perfectly still while 10-year-old me attempted to draw you. Thank you for reading my script 3 times over and sending me a letter with your favorite line written on the envelope. Thank you for realizing things about me that I never even realized about myself. And thank you for sharing those realizations with me, good or bad, because they helped me become the person that I am today. Thank you for being my biggest fan, even when you didn't know exactly what you were cheering for. Thank you for caring so much about me, and more importantly, caring so much about everything, because you taught me to be passionate about the things that I love. Oh, and of course, thank you for the orange juice. It was great.
On a scale from 1 to 10, how happy are you? And never let me reply with a perfect 10 because I had to leave room for improvement. My grandmother was so many things to me, and I love her so much. She has given me many things in life, from sketch pads to memory-written tchotchkes, but most of all, she has given me her love. I know what wonderful work my grandmother did for the theater world, but that's not why she is so special to me. She cared so deeply for me and wanted to know everything I had to tell her about my life. We would talk about relationships I had between friends, about my teachers, about my dreams. I would send her my writing that I did for school, and she would read and reread it, and we would talk for hours about what she thought. She would read me pieces of it aloud in her beautiful, rich voice, which made even my worst writing sound so much better. Over the years, I ended up with plenty of messages on my answering machine from her. Last night, I realized I still have a lot of these messages, so I listened to them. Some were reminding me that she'd love to hear my voice, some just to tell me she's thinking of me. And one she said, I'd like to hear from you when you have another little burst of happiness. And lately, I've had a bunch of these little bursts. I wish I could tell her about my first months at college. I'd send her my first college essay and get comfortable with a cup of tea to listen to all she would have to say about it. I would tell her about my completely out of character newfound love for swing dance and explain what it feels like to be making a brand new home for myself. She'd listen, and I'm sure in the next few days, I'd be getting a long letter in the mail about what she thinks about my college experience. I know she would tell me to call soon and ask how well I'm doing on a scale of 1 to 10, reminding me to leave room for her. She would tell me to let her know if I have a burst of happiness, and most importantly, she would just tell me that she's thinking of me. Right now, I wish I could go back in her apartment, looking at Grammy with her beautiful style and loving eyes, a woman who knows me better and loves me more than many other people. I wish I could tell her about my life and tell her that I'm thinking of her.
Ladies and gentlemen, Hal Fichandler.
thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts with you. The center of my little family, by which I mean the four of us, every family has a center, and the center of my family is my wife, Susan, who's here today. We all revolve around her sunshine. In 1997, shortly after my father died, I received a call from an old friend from college who had read Dad's obituary in the New York Times. He said something to me then that I've never forgotten. Now is the time that you decide what to remember. I was born about a year and a half after ArenaStage was founded, so I'm the second longest living production of So there's a lot to remember. So let me start with the words of a very young person, a 13-year-old teenager who had just graduated from Alice Deal Junior High School and lived with her parents, Harry and Ida Diamond, and her sister, Joyce, at 3226 Northampton Street in Northwest Washington, D.C. Dear editor, there comes a time in every girl's life when she wants to become an actress. Perhaps this desire is born because of being a witness to a great performance and observing the applause, fame, and recognition afforded the performers. Most likely, this desire is not the want to act, but the wish to be an actress who is famous and sought out. However, I think that this is not altogether the case with me. For although I have taken dramatic lessons for 2 years and participated in many plays, I find that it is the love of the work persists. I do admit, however, that I enjoy to the utmost the very small bit of recognition I have received and find it extremely pleasant. During my years of grammar school, I've been in quite a few presentations and performed on several programs, besides having some experience in writing and presenting plays. In the sixth grade, I wrote a play, and again in the eighth, with the additional job of helping to manage it. Upon entering high school in the fall, I hope to continue these activities and to further them with outside training. I think they will help toward my aim for the future. Considering the fact that music goes hand in hand with certain types of dramatics, I intend to continue this study, which I began 4 years ago. So, with my high ambition to be a stage actress, I hope to climb the ladder of fame and perhaps reach the top rung. So wish me luck, I'll need it. Respectfully yours, Zelda Diamond. Mom wrote those words when she entered a contest sponsored by the Washington Star, the newspaper of record at the time, as she won third prize. And with that came a substantial reward of $1. Well, she didn't need the luck. And she didn't become a professional actress, but in that letter already was the essential core of what defined Mom. I find that it is the love of the work that persists. Her work in the theater was her life. It was her great and limitless passion and her great and limitless joy. It is what we are all here today to celebrate. The theater was her life, yes, but so was her family. And here's some of what I decide to remember as her son. The name tapes. It was time for my first summer camp, 4 weeks in Massachusetts. Mom was determined that the clothes I went with would be the clothes I came home with. So she ordered name tapes, and one by one, hand-sewed each one to my pants, my shirts, my towels, my socks, my underwear, my everything. So many name tapes. And when she proudly presented them to me, I looked at them and we noticed together for the first time that each and every one of them said, Hal Fichandler. All we could do was laugh. I took them to camp. As I grew up, Mom carved out the time to do so many parental things for me. She helped me rehearse my very first oral report in elementary school. As I recall, the topic was oysters. She taught me how to organize all my research for my first major paper into topic-specific piles of 3x5 file cards. Franklin Roosevelt and the New Deal, that was their topic. In the end, Fichandler or Fichandler, it really didn't matter. Next, the measles. When I was 9, I came down with the measles. Unfortunately, I also came down with the dangerous side effect, encephalitis, a potentially fatal swelling of the brain. I was lucky. I woke up from a coma in the hospital a few days later, and the first person I laid eyes on was Mom, who had been there almost the whole time and was holding a bottle of soda. For years after, we both remembered that the first words I said and the reason we knew I was going to be okay were something terribly profound. Can I have a slug of that Coke? Mom came through in the clutch. She faced life head on, took the bad with the good. If you were sick or in emotional pain, if you needed something, if you were in harm's way, she was there. She rose to the occasion. She never turned away, never said, I can't handle this, it's too painful. Life wasn't a walk in the park for her. It was a forest with dark places and light places and fascinating mysteries and infinite places to explore. The athlete. When I was a kid, we would visit Mom's mother at her home on Northampton Street. The neat thing about this for me was that in the basement, there was a ping pong table. We would go down there and play. It was a blast. That's where I learned to love the game. I played endlessly when we got our own table in our own basement. Mom was pretty good, with a solid serve and a consistent, deliberate backhand. And when Dad took me to Lafayette Playground to take tennis lessons from a former boxer with one eye, he charged a couple bucks an hour so everyone could afford him. Mom sometimes came along and took her own lessons. I can picture her standing, ready to receive a serve, her racket poised in front of her, exactly as instructed. She was a trooper, and she gave it her best shot. The parachute. As a parent, Mom worried about the risks that the world might throw our way. The physical world scared her a little. I didn't know about the sailboat. She would swim in the summertime, but she refused to dunk her head under the water. She drove back and forth from home to the theater 10,000 times, but I don't think she ever drove on a highway. She sent us countless clippings about the dangers of this and the risks of that. So, I was a freshman or sophomore at college, and one day a man came to the campus to invite anyone who was interested to jump out of an airplane. He was selling parachute jumps for novices. No experience required. Several of my friends and I signed up, and the next time I was speaking with my parents, I mentioned this upcoming adventure. Big mistake. All hell broke loose. In Mom's mind, I was jumping to a certain death. She pulled out all the stops, letters, phone calls, weeping. My dad called. Your mother is very, very upset. She can't sleep. She persuaded my brother, who remembers this, to write me. Mom was very good at getting her way. Her emotional intensity was formidable. On a dial that goes up to 10, she was a 15. So I surrendered. My friends, on the other hand, jumped and survived. I'll never know. The messages. Sometime in my late 20s, after I moved to Philadelphia, I bought my first answering machine from Radio Shack, which used a cassette tape to record messages. It could hold up to 30 minutes of messages at a time, which struck me as plenty. Who leaves long messages? Who do you think? I would get home and the message light would be flashing, and for the next 20 minutes or until the tape ran out, I would hear the events of the day, the events of the world, whatever Mom was thinking about. It was an unconventional conversation, as though I was there all the time. I can't say I listened to every word, but I listened to a lot. She welcomed long messages in return. I won't get this exactly right, but any of you who called her in New York and got her voicemail will remember this. Hello, this is Zell. I can't come to the phone right now, but tell me everything. And I'll call you back. She spilled over with the wish to connect and be connected. We were not the same people. Mom had a voracious appetite to understand the human condition. She read, she studied, she analyzed. She was a magnet to strangers on planes. I don't know why they talk to me, but they do. No point in borrowing her books. They were destroyed with heavy underlining and comments in the margins. Sometimes it's got to me, because the truth is I live on a slightly shallower plane. Sometimes a thing is just a thing, and all that matters is whether the Cubs will finally break the curse. And win the World Series. So one day after Mom had said something deeply probing and meaningful about who knows what, I got exasperated and I barked at her. Why does everything have to mean something? Why do you always have to try to be so profound? And she looked at me and she smiled and she said, but I like to be profound. And that was the end of that discussion. She never stopped probing for the essence of humanity. And I, well, I'll be watching the Cleveland Indians take on the Cubs. Randy, as you've heard from Matthew and Emily, and it brought tears to my eyes, Mom was a devoted grandmother and not in some slapdash way. Letters, hundreds of letters, balloons and cards every birthday, many trips to Philadelphia on the train when she could barely walk because of her hip pain, and when walking on uneven ground was out of the question, we would push her in a wheelchair to the edge of a tennis court so she could watch Matthew, Emily, Susan, and me play. A never-ending effort to know what was going on in their lives and inside their lives. She devoured whatever they wrote and kept everything in folders that Mark and I discovered when clearing out her apartment. A howl and then tears of joy when Matthew surprised her with his letter of admission to college. And although this afternoon is about how exceptional Mom was, she was also a typical doting grandmother. Hal, are you listening to me? I'm telling you, she would say. And I'm not just saying this because I'm their grandmother. Your kids are special, really special. Do you realize that? Do you see that? Last silence. Mom had her deep fears and doubts, but she was resilient and brave. Her body was not her ally, however. She experienced substantial physical pain for many years. Because of the two hip replacements on the same side, for many years she had to sit a certain way, walk a certain way to prevent a dislocation. But at times that happened anyway. For decades, she fought and overcame her own fragility. Mom was adamant that she live out her days in her home, and she planned everything meticulously so this could happen. Doorways wide enough that a wheelchair could easily pass, an eloquent advance directive that told us what she wanted, long-term care insurance purchased many years ago to help cover the cost of assistance. So of course we honored her wish. We could not have done that alone. In her last year, it took the incredible help of many people, some of whom we want to acknowledge here today. Guy already mentioned Angie, but I want to mention you again. Angie, who basically helped Mom manage her life, setting up email accounts, paying bills, handling mountains of paperwork, gathering and researching materials for her, writing out instructions on how to use the TV and the toaster oven, and accompanying her whenever Mom needed emergency transport to a hospital. You were an amazing friend to Mom. To stay home, Mom needed the care of nurse's aides at the end, and we were so lucky to have four wonderful and kind people who worked in rotation. Wilhelmina Barrett and Jeanette Eason helped on weekends. Vilma Woolery worked almost every weeknight and some weekends. And finally, there was Janet Aikum, there every weekday and many days on the weekend as well, giving our mother unqualified love and unlimited patience, opening her heart and holding her hands. In Mom's last days, words, the words she loved to hear and use and play with, failed her at last. So now there is silence. But as Mom taught me, silence, the absence of words, has its own rich meaning. And so here is my single strongest memory from all of the plays I saw at ArenaStage. The play was Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman, which Mom directed as part of the 1974-75 season. In the scene I remember, the stage was bare. Out from one of the wings comes a weary, middle-aged man carrying two heavy suitcases containing samples, the burden of a traveling salesman, Willie Loman, played by Robert Prosky, home after an unsuccessful trip through his vast sales territory. So tired, no words, his sagging shoulders spoke for him. I'll never forget it. When Mark and I were going through Mom's papers, I found the draft of a letter to her grandchildren that she never completed. It was in contemplation of her own death, and I'd like to close by sharing a small part of it. She wrote, "I do believe that if one is remembered in the minds and hearts of others, one is always alive. Remember me. I feel privileged to have had the family that was given me. Here's a hug, one for each of you. I love you." Thank you.
I stand here today in the house that you and Tom built, aptly named the Fichandler Stage, designed by your favorite architect, Howard Meese. It is not only the anchor for the Mead Center for American Theater, it is also the anchor for the new Southwest redevelopment called the Piers. Remember when Mac Lowry came, a Ford Foundation, who for many years was your sole source of income, came and said to you, "ArenaStage has matured, and I think you can support itself." You and Tom said, "How?" And then you said, "We can do it. We must do it." Step by step, season by season, you did it. You and I have spent over 15 very rewarding years working together. From you, I learned how theater works, the beautiful art of theater, and probably more importantly, how Zelda Fichandler's mind and heart work. Everyone in theater and the arts knows of your innovation and perseverance and how you gave birth to and nurtured a totally new concept of theater. I also learned that theater exists, it must necessarily have a balanced budget. You taught me that, and I really agree with you. You taught me that the funds can not only come from the box office. If you tried to raise the ticket prices, you would not have the audience that you were wanting to attract. What a teacher, what an understanding. At one time, I apologized, Zell, for bothering you with budget talk. Then you answered me, I love a budget. A budget is a sculpture of the art. One day, I came to you and Tom and said, I think we need an endowment. What? Who is going to give us that? I said, I think we could raise $6 million with a capital campaign. Well, we thought about it. I heard Zelda say, I believe that optimism, an aspect of hope, is in itself a creative force. With that optimism, we decided to go forth and we did. In preparing the brochure and the case statement for the endowment, Zelda, in all her wisdom and optimism, stated, like museums and libraries, theater is an instrument of civilization, which became our motto for the campaign. We raised $6.3 million, which was the first major endowment in the theater in this country. In the last 30 years, this endowment has contributed over $12 million to the annual operating budget. The international renown Liviu Chiule once said of Zelda, Zelda created something that is very hard to create in theater. She was responsible for the very air. Her footsteps were everywhere. Zelda once said at a TCG conference of theater professionals, the theory of relativity tells us that time passes more slowly when an object in motion than one at rest. And that sure explains to me how Zelda Fichandler accomplished everything that she did in one lifetime. I was privileged to have 4 or 5 visits with Zelda within the last 6 weeks. And she would go in and out. Well, one time, she said, we got to do something about raising those ticket prices all the time. It really bothered her. I feel when a person dies, their immortality exists in the memory of others. And I would propose that we all here are witnesses who declare Zelda Fichandler is immortal. Trina, can you come up? The Fichandler family has requested that we say Kaddish for Zelda. Please join us if you will. Yiskadah, Yiskadah, Shaynabah, Yomah, Yorisah, Yisay, Yomah, Yorisah, Yomah, 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 Yomah,
harvest, no harvest, no say. This at the harvest, a lady, a love, to make her show free of her. Lay on me, call your hearts up, she's a rock. To each Picasso, the nephew also, the Lord be Alma, be a girl, amen. The Haish, Lama, Rabba, and Shemaya, the Chaim, Malay, the Alcohol, the Sreya, the Ruhm, amen. O say shalom, we grow up. We are say shalom. Away with the Alcohol, the Sreya, the Ruhm.
Thank you, Lee, and thank you, everyone, and thank you to the great Zelda Fichandler, who watches over us and whose presence I feel so strongly here today. The memories are remarkable and powerful, and I'd love it if we continue sharing in the lobby. We have Zelda's favorite ice cream, and cookies and savories and things for people to eat and drink and talk to each other. So many of you have come from so far away to join us today, and I know that there are reunions of people who haven't seen each other for 20 or 30 years. So please enjoy this day. Zelda would like this little bit of fun as well. Thank you.